The New York Giants take on the Dallas Cowboys now for football, American style. Plus the latest on the players' strike.
Good evening and welcome to tonight's show. Normally as we go on air on a Sunday, the big games are starting all over America, but the player strike has put an end to all that. The strike started on Monday night straight after the Jets and Patriots game, and it looks like taking some time to resolve.
Jack Donlan, the owner's negotiator, said it will be 6 to 8 weeks serious bargaining to come to any resolution. And on the other hand, Gene Upshaw, the player's representative, said the current management proposals are garbage.
But the owners are planning on continuing the season using scab teams of strike breakers starting on October the 4th.
This has brought derision from the fans and media alike, being summed up by this cartoon in the New York Daily News.
Feel like a light workout before we get the call to the Super Bowl?
John Smith went to Sullivan Stadium, home of the New England Patriots, to see how the situation was affecting them.
Here at Sullivan Stadium, with all the games cancelled this week, this strike is affecting three separate groups. The players on strike outside the stadium, these substitute players behind me, and the coaches and management who have to get this group ready for the Cleveland Browns in 2 weeks. So how hard is it for you, Lynn, to keep the players interested and keep the players involved in this?
Well, it's not hard to keep anybody, to keep the players interested. The thing is, we just want to stick together as a team, because the team that sticks together after this is all over, and it will be over sometime, is going to have a greater chance to go to the Super Bowl.
Pete, we went through this in 1982. Did you ever think it would come up again?
I would have laid the odds this has never happened again, just because of, I think, the outcome of it. No one wins in a strike situation. I think we all found that out in 82. I was really surprised that it came to this.
Enjoy this picket line?
No, I'd rather be out figuring out what the Washington Redskins are doing defensively so we can get ready to play. That's what I prepared all year for, is to play football, and now we're not doing that.
How good are they?
All these guys are good athletes. You've got to remember that, you know, they probably were the best players at their colleges, wherever they played. And so they are all of them exceptional athletes, and they all play good football.
Steve, when did you start making plans for these substitute players coming in?
Well, actually, in training camp, we anticipated that there might be a strike, and so as we released the players, we told them that if there was a strike, we would be interested in bringing them back because they know our system.
But how difficult was it when you actually have to come around to getting players in here?
Well, it hasn't been easy because, you know, we probably only had access to about 25 players that we had that were interested. Many of them had jobs and went back to school and they didn't want to drop out. So, we probably initially got 15, 18 guys real quickly, and then we've really had to kind of make a lot of calls to accumulate the rest of the squad. And we're still trying to get more players.
Now, many of these players are looking for a chance to break into the NFL. If you find a couple that are real good and the players come back in a couple of weeks, what sort of problem does that present?
Well, you know, that happens each time there's a strike. There was one in 74, which I think was just before you got into the league. Then there was one in 82, and there were guys that came in that got the exposure and the repetition in practice. Unfortunately for some marginal players, they replaced them. And I would expect that would happen this time, too, if we play a couple of games at least.
What do you feel about being out here playing when a lot of your teammates from last year are out there on the picket line?
I know it's going to ruffle a few feathers. Obviously it is, but I was sitting at home spending money, and I have things that I want to do with my life. After this is all over, they're going to come back and they're going to earn their money, and I'm going to be back home sitting around. So that, to me, it was an opportunity to get money to start my business for further things besides football, because it didn't look like it was in my future.
What will be the economic impact on the New England Patriots if there's a strike for a few weeks?
Well, I think it'd be quite severe, because we're going to refund ticket money to season ticket holders and individual ticket holders who don't want to pay to see these games, and I don't think television will continue to pay the fees that they are committed to if the ratings fall off. So I think there would be quite a bit of economic problem if we have to play several games.
So how long do you think it'll last?
Well, hopefully just another week.
Two teams that play for no money met last Sunday at the Budweiser Bowl, the Manchester All-Stars versus the London Ravens. And here is
Delton Anderson from the London Ravens.
Now then,
why is it that you go out every week and play the game when you're not getting paid?
Oh, for the hitting.
The hitting?
Yeah.
Ah, right, here's your man. And while they're doing that, we'll have a look at the highlights of the Budweiser Bowl.
Last Sunday, the two teams met on the AstroTurf of Loftus Road. Neither team had lost this season, so we were due for a good match. In the first quarter, London Ravens took an early lead, with quarterback Ron Roberts Jr. handing off to number 30, running back Joe St. Louis, for a 43-yard touchdown. Ravens on the scoreboard once again as wide receiver Brian Downer teams up with Roberts for a 15-yard touchdown pass.
Into the second quarter, and Ravens star Victor Abubadike powers through from the 5-yard line to make it 19-0 at half-time.
Abubadike explodes once again with this 73-yard sprint, showing just why the American colleges are so interested in him. All-Stars first touchdown, Rick Bolin with an 18-yard pass to number 2, Jim Nendel, makes it Ravens 26, All-Stars 6. The All-Stars fight back continues as Rick Bolin and Jim Nendel team up once again.
Into the last quarter, and Abubadike bulldozes in for his third score of the match. This was followed up by Ravens captain Mark Winnick, wrapping it up for the Ravens with this 6-yard touchdown run. And finally, the last touchdown of the match was scored by the All-Stars by running back Nick Goff, leaving the final score at London Ravens 40, Manchester All-Stars 23. So it's Mark Winnick, the triumphant Ravens captain, collecting the Budweiser Bowl trophy at the end of the game.
I'm here with the coach of the winning team, and here he is. In between this guy here, it's Ron Roberts, and he's the coach of the Ravens. How was it for you?
Well, it was very good. I can't be more happier. This was a great game. It was fun for the people to watch, and I was glad that it came out with we had the most points.
And the start of the third quarter looked a bit shaky there. It looked as if the All-Stars were going to come back. Were you worried then?
I always get worried.
Yeah.
Until it's all over with, I'm always worried. But it worked out all right. We got the momentum back, and they're a good team.
Yeah. It looked like the All-Stars were really trying to kind of pass the ball a lot, and you were rushing.
Well, yeah, that's their game. They throw the ball all the time. Yeah. Every time I've seen them, that's all they do, and they do it very well. Yeah.
Delton, unbeaten in this country now for 6 years, and you're off to the Europe Bowl. Are you going to bring it back for us?
Oh, we're going to win.
You're going to win?
Yes.
Good. Okay, well, it's into tonight's game now between the Giants and the Cowboys. Are you all right here?
I'm fine. Just leave me.
The New York Giants' climb to a Super Bowl championship provided some proud and lasting memories. But those memories were abruptly and rudely erased in their season opener at Chicago. The unpleasant taste of defeat is an uncommon one for the world champions, and today their wrath could be a bad taste for Dallas. A similar script unfolded last week for Tom Landry and his Dallas Cowboys, who were hammered into submission by St. Louis. Today, Danny White attempts to get his team on track, and that means unleashing the explosive backfield tandem of Herschel Walker and Tony Dorsett, who are capable of writing Coach Landry a more palatable script. The Giants opened last season with a frustrating loss to Dallas, while later in the year, the Cowboys not only lost the rematch, but quarterback Danny White as well.
Well, the Giants started to move the ball in familiar fashion in the first quarter. Phil Simms hitting Lionel Manuel for the potential first down until Everson Wall's tackle forced Manuel to drop the ball and Ron Francis recovered for the Cowboys. But Danny White's passing game is still hindered by the weakness of his wrist, which was broken by the Giants' Carl Banks last season. He couldn't get any grip on the ball and the Cowboys had to punt. So now it's Giants first and 10 on their own 28.